session on urban freshwater ecosystems, resilience tools in a climate uncertain future. I'm Sahana Goswami. I'm a manager with the Cities Program at WRI India. So I will also be a speaker later, but also the host of this session and sort of take you along with on this entire discussion that we have planned. This webinar is part of a 10-part e-learning series, which has been launched in partnership with the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs and National Institute of Urban Affairs, along with various alliance partners and city authorities. And through this series, what we hope to do is build a common understanding in cities about climate change and the role urban authorities can play in mainstreaming climate actions, be it through policies and regulations, planning and implementation of various programs and projects. A quick brief note about what we'll talk about in this session itself. So if climate change and its impacts on cities were not front and center in our minds so far, with this recently launched report from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, we must move it to the center of all of our planning to meet the forthcoming challenges that we are likely to face. And what the report tells us is that we are already seeing irreversible changes to global climate, which will cause major disruptions in our established weather patterns. So for India and for other regions in South Asia, particularly, the forecast is that there'll be an increase in heat stress. There will be an increase in the amount of rainfall we get for our entire annual and summer monsoons. And there is definitely going to be an increase in extreme weather events such as floods and droughts and heat stress events. But what the report is telling us now is something that we have been seeing in Indian cities for the past few years. A lot of our cities have been facing these extreme weather events, be it the case of Chennai in December 2015, or last year, October of 2020 in Hyderabad, or just this year, the amount of news we have about extreme rainfall and landslides and flooding in small hill towns in Himachal and Uttarakhand. So cities with the much larger population they hold and them being our economic centers, they are both vulnerable, but also the places where we must urgently move to meet these future dangers that we have. And a key step towards this preparedness and resilience for urban centers, we feel at WRI and a lot of other partner agencies that we work with, will be to leverage our natural capacities. So be it our lakes and rivers, our floodplains, wetlands, forests, we have to leverage the capacities and benefits that these sort of natural ecosystems offer to provide us from the protection that we need from this increasing amount of extreme weather that is forecast. Joining the WRI team today, I would really like to thank the team from the Nature Conservancy, which is Alpana Jain and Nisha Priyamani, who will be speaking about their experiences and their knowledge from on-field experiences, really, about how they have been moving forward to try and leverage natural capacities. And also a very warm welcome to Mr. G.R. Radhakrishnan, who is an assistant executive engineer with Public Works Department, Government of Tamil Nadu. He has almost 2 decades of experience working in the Water Resources Organization at PWD, and he is in charge of various projects in City of Chennai, which feature nature-based or ecosystem-based solutions. And we are really thankful to all of them for taking time out to be part of this session and to share their experience with us. That's sort of our introduction. Himanshi, if it's fine and we are keeping well with time, I'll just switch to the presentation that WRI will be giving now. So I'll be talking about restoring urban natural ecosystems to create resilient cities. And this will be some of the work that we are doing in WRI. And of course, much of it is very general. I'm sure that many of you have come across. But I hope to give sort of a broad overarching view that will help us give this introduction and from where we will move on to the much more detailed, in-depth cases that we'll hear about Chennai from both the Nature Conservancy and from Mr. Radhakrishnan. So essentially, I've broken this into 2 parts. So one is really understanding what the situation is now, which is how water, urbanization, and climate change sort of are interacting in cities in India. And then the other piece of this this presentation is to talk, given the many challenges that we are facing. So when we talk of the challenges for Indian cities and for many other cities across the world too, increasingly, they are sort of broken into three parts. It's either that we have too little water when we need it, or we have too much water, or the water is just too dirty. And not to say that this happened, that we'll probably find cities which don't have any of these issues. Like if you take any of our Indian cities, I'm sure all of us will recognize pockets of this in all of our cities. So it's not just an issue of clearing this in an entire city. It's just that there are pockets which are more vulnerable, which have disadvantaged communities who still struggle with these things. So if most of the city might have been improved, there are still places where these challenges still occur. But this is what we see. But then we have to think a little bit of what is the reason behind these sort of issues. And this is just a quick snapshot of looking at Google Earth images. And all of us can do this. This isn't very high tech. But this is something that comes across so apparently. This is an example from Bangalore. And we see two place in 2003 and 2020. And it's very clear that what was originally a stretch of lakeland of development. So this is one of the things that we're doing, that what was essentially a place where water would flow, we have built over there. The other thing we have done, and this is an example from Hyderabad, is just a GIF that we put together from multiple satellite images again of the area around Durgam Cheruvu. And what we can see is starts off fairly barren and wild, and then as it progresses closer and closer to about 2017 and 2019, is this completely built up profile. And of course, that is impacting how water moves in our cities. And not to say it's just places in India. This is a photograph from Houston, Texas in 2016 after Hurricane Harvey, which was an enormously extreme weather event, very erratic and amount of rainfall that happened in a very short amount of time, which is really what climate change is doing, right? This is the sort of extremity of rainfall that we are seeing, which is happening in a very short duration of time. So even if our cities have planned extremely good stormwater drainage systems and engineered systems to remove rainwater, the amount of rain that comes in such short durations is just overwhelming any of these design systems. And as I said, this isn't just in India, this is a problem across. So if we look at Hyderabad last year, which was a very similar case of really short duration with extreme high rainfall, or Germany this year. This is what is happening across the world, really. And that's possibly what we need to think of as we plan for improving our cities and making them more resilient. But then we talk of, those are sort of photographs and you might call them anecdotal evidence. So what sort of science-based or spatial evidence might we have? And this is a snapshot from some research that we are doing at WRI recently, which is soon to be published. And essentially what we see is the gray color bars are telling us where urban growth has increased. So this is essentially the footprint of our roads and buildings. The green shows us where vegetation has changed, and the blue shows us where blue cover of lakes or water bodies that have been there in our cities and how they have changed. And what we see is, well, except for Ahmedabad and Jaipur, which are sort of unique in this case, all other cities seem to have lost green cover and blue cover, whereas gray cover has increased, which sort of the correlation being that as our built footprint has increased, we definitely have lost out on our natural resources. This is just looking at the 0 to 20 kilometer area from the city center, which is much more of the core city. But then our urban profile is just extending way beyond. And what we see in the 20 to 50 kilometer range is this, the amount of gray cover that's increasing there is much higher. Please do remember, this is just a percentage that we are talking of. So it might be that in whole numbers, they are not big, but the pace at which this is happening is really fast and is sort of a guideline on how the future is likely to extend as well. And what happens because of this, again, is just going back to those initial photographs that we had, is that we have these recurring events of floods and droughts, because we might have flood 1 year, but it's just followed by extreme drought after that. And that's part of the reason is how we have built, because by growing our gray impermeable cover where water cannot. But there are other challenges as well. So one, of course, is infrastructure damage, because anytime we have this amount of flooding, it's private property that's being lost, but as well as infrastructure. So for example, the Mumbai case just last month, with the heavy rainfall that they had to shut down their water treatment plant because that got flooded. And water treatment plants getting flooded means safe water supply is affected for many people in the city. So these are the sort of issues we see talk of climate change driven impacts in urban areas. It's not just the flooding, there's so much more to it. And all of these things are what city governments really have to think of and prepare for now. So now the challenges, of course, are that urbanization in India is still increasing. We are not just going to stop at where we are, like 35% urban, right? People are just going to move to cities because there are still benefits that cities are offering. And we need to provide safe and adequate housing for all of our urban residents. And we need to provide space for businesses, industries, which means that our cities will grow. It's just not possible to say that we will stop growing our cities at this point. That wouldn't be fair to all the people who need opportunities to come. So if this situation is there, do we have the luxury to say that, our cities need to grow? But if we are growing, we can't also consider our natural systems and protect them because our development needs are so high. And I feel to a great extent, this is the path we have followed, that our development needs are high. We are a developing country. We need to reach this level of productivity, economic productivity, and hence we can't look at natural systems. But unfortunately, with climate change, with the amount of devastation we see brought about by these erratic weather events, we really need to understand that the cost of not protecting our natural systems is just going to be higher. So what is the future then, if we are talking of all of the challenges that we have faced? So we talk of co-creating this resilient urban future, and what would that mean? That we understand the problem, right? That we have floods, we have drought, it's uncertain, it's extreme, and it's frequent. And these are all of our challenges. But if you want resilient cities, they can't be just resilient to only floods or to only droughts. They have to also be resilient towards heat stress. They should have adequate air quality because all of these things together are what will provide, make cities more livable, hopefully more equitable and inclusive. Like all of these things have to come together for us to talk of resilient cities. It isn't just enough to say that we will have cities where no floods will occur and that will be enough when people still are living in very impoverished conditions. But to arrive at that, one of the approaches that we talk of, and this is something that globally a lot of other organizations talk of, is to leverage the capacities of nature, because nature does have mechanisms in it to be able to absorb a lot of weather extremes. And particularly when we see it in the context of water and cities, what we are looking at is that cities can be designed in such manner that they actually help in this sort of nature-based solution agenda. So to reduce the effect of having too much rainfall or too little, what we need to do is provide interventions in the city which help absorb a lot of rainwater when it falls, direct it into the ground instead of just letting it flow away. And what we see is that the interventions themselves could be lakes or parks, but they are not a single solution. That one intervention can do multiple things. And I think that's an important thing to remember about urban resilience, nature-based solutions for urban resilience, that it's very unlike doing one stormwater sewer network, which only removes stormwater, versus if we put in a wetland, it can help absorb floodwaters, it can improve biodiversity, it can possibly help with water quality treatment, and so on. So that's something to remember. But how do we get to this future? Apologies if you see some lines on the screen, I'm not sure why that happened. And to understand that there are a lot of other cities across the world who have done certain very progressive things, if you will. So there's this example of Vancouver, where they have put in this hybrid approach to stormwater management, where they clearly understand that along with your gray water networks, you also want your blue and green networks to work together. And this is something that we have to arrive at. We often think of just this one thing is going to be the solution, but it really has to be a combination. Or we have the example of Netherlands, who say room for rivers and are actually going back to making the rivers more wild, if you will, giving them more space to flood. Because floods, again, the thing with floods is it's a natural process. We identify it as being harmful because we have so many things of value in the path of floods. But if there was enough space for rivers to flood naturally, there are benefits to doing that. And this is Netherlands' perspective. I'm giving sort of global examples, but definitely what we'll hear about Chennai is going to be the local example of how we can do this in Indian cities. Just these lighthouse examples, which tell us that it's possible in India as well. But a couple of steps before we get to that. So the first thing, of course, is if we want to do it in India, and this is sort of WRI thinking on it, I'm sure the Nature Conservancy will be telling us their approach, which is much more grounded on what's happening, you know, what the real situation is on ground. But to begin off, just being able to do this sort of visualization or understanding of where our water networks are, how the water flows, you know, and what these interconnections are, can help us start off, because we need to know this to understand how we are vulnerable. And the other thing is to overlay it with how landscape is changing. And this again goes back to the point that our cities will grow. It isn't justified or fair to say that we will stop growing our cities and not let anyone else come in. But how we grow, that is definitely something that we have to consider and think of. And this is where urban authorities really have to shift mindsets and think of that we are growing, but can we do it in a much more manner which is still mimics or replicates natural systems. And here I will just give a few examples of what other places have done. And I'll leave the Indian examples to other speakers next. So China has this huge project that they are doing of sponge cities. They're just talking of entire cities, which by 2050 will absorb like 75% of the rainwater that falls on them. And this is something to consider, that when will Indian cities also start putting such ambitious targets in place? Because, you know, when you have that ambitious target and you work towards it is when you possibly can try and achieve to that level. Copenhagen has a cloudburst plan. They have an entire plan for the city where they have redesigned their public spaces in such a manner that they can become receptacles of water if there's excess rainfall. This is a direct reaction to a 2011 cloudburst that the city faced, and there was a huge amount of damage to property and a loss of life as well. And there's this example from Singapore where they had this stormwater drain flowing through one of their parks, which frankly is quite an ugly stormwater drain that they had at that point. But they changed it and made it sort of a rewilded river as part of this green space. And what they have managed to achieve through that is this incredible public space in the middle of the city for citizens to use. A wild river which has biodiversity in it. And because of the way it's designed, it floods naturally, but is also this space which allows the rest of the city to stay safe because the floodwaters can be brought over here. And one very interesting thing that they managed to do with this is that they spent way lesser on this instead of if they had chosen the path of just overhauling and redoing their gray infrastructure, that is just stormwater drains. So this is also something to consider as we go forward. And it doesn't have to be big projects and interventions, right? There can be small scale ones, like just redesigning the way our streets are done so that we have more permeable spaces. This actually is an example from Delhi, where a wastewater treatment plant, a public space, a park space has been created together, which acts as an urban sponge and absorbs floodwaters, absorbs this treated wastewater. And this is the way to go forward, I think, is where we look at spaces not that they will give us one function or one benefit, but multiple things built in. And similarly with New York City, where they have a larger plan, of course, but then these are the sort of small interventions and elements that they have built into their approach, which allows them to actually improve their flood protection. And also water quality improvement, which is a possibility with these sort of interventions. And I'll just quickly end with three slides about, we talk of all of this, but if you don't find the money for it, how do we do it? So we talk of, and this is just sort of initial sort of research and findings that we have ongoing. So the first thing is land value capture. And a prime example for this actually is the New York City Central Park, which looked at doing land value capture to fund the way the city could put in this park. And that's something to see, consider, that this is a high value public assets that is being created, green spaces or blue spaces, and the city must find ways to leverage the benefits, the land value benefits that come out of it, particularly for property that surrounds it, so that it can feed into the city's budget and so on. The other model, of course, is something that we tried out in Mexico, WRI tried out in Mexico, which is a challenge model. So there were funds available, which were available to city governments if the city government committed to doing purely green infrastructure projects. So say, for example, we have Amrut and, you know, Smart Cities Mission, but imagine if they had a layer which said they would fund green infrastructure projects exclusively, just the way that things could change. And the third thing that this is, again, something WRI has been working on, and it's very preliminary, but talking of how different government departments can come together and pool their resources, maybe under a method of a joint benefit authority, to then deliver high quality projects. But those projects actually give multiple benefits, right? So that is the reason of bringing these different departments together. So it isn't just that, say, the public works department has to bear the entire cost, but the public works department, the parks department, the water supply department could come together to fund projects because they are all going to derive benefits out of that. So that's sort of this broad overview presentation that I have for you. I'll stop sharing now, and we'll be moving on to our colleagues from the Nature Conservancy to give their presentation.
Thank you so much, Sahana. Really informative. I request Alpana to share her screen, or maybe Nisha. And just a small announcement for the participants. If you have any questions, please feel free to put them in the chat box. We will take up after the other two presentations are done. In the end, we have a question answer round. Please feel free, whatever questions you have, and put it in the chat box. Thank you. Over to you, Alpana.
Sorry, can I cut in, Alpana? I apologize. I forgot to introduce you and Nisha. Just give me a minute.
No worries.
To all our attendees, first we'll have Alpana Jain speaking. She is the program lead for the Cities Program at the Nature Conservancy India. And she has extensive experience working on environment, energy, and climate. And she has been working for many years in the development sector, particularly for in relation to this presentation and this session. She oversees TNC's Sustainable Cities portfolio and manages the project around restoring wetlands in Chennai, and also for developing an urban green print for Chennai. And alongside this, of course, she drives the strategic thinking at TNC for the Cities Program to build climate resilience into their urban planning using nature-based solutions. The other speaker from TNC is Nisha Priyamani, who's a project manager with the Cities Program, and she has 15 years of experience in the field on natural resources management. And her current role, she is managing the wetland restoration project in Chennai and focuses on developing science and evidence-based approaches to arrive at sustainable outcomes. Thank you both for joining us, and over to you, Alpana.
Thank you, Sahana, and thank you, Himanshi. So I think Sahana has given a pretty good overview of what our cities are facing today. So I will, while I had planned to speak a little on that, I will not delve into too much detail there. So just to give you a little sense of what the Nature Conservancy is, and we have been working in Chennai for almost 4 or 5 years now, and that's really when TNC came to India. So TNC is one of the world's largest conservation organization, and we are present in more than 70 countries. And in India, we are fairly new. We've been here for about five plus years now. And the main focus of TNC is to bring the connect with nature and provide nature-based solutions, which are completely backed by science. We work on three critical areas. One is providing food and water sustainably. We are working in India, we are working currently on ending the crop residue burning. In North India, which is, you know, so much in the news every year, we see so much air pollution happening. We are looking at protecting land and water. This is our work in Central India, where we are focusing on conserving and restoring high conservation value land, and also At the same time, looking at freshwater ecosystems in the area, like the Narmada River, where we are working towards restoring a small stretch of it. And finally, where Nisha and I presently work is tackling climate change and building healthy cities. For this work, we are particularly focusing in Chennai city at the moment. And the idea is to address the challenges that climate change is bringing to cities, as well as the aggressive urbanization is causing to our cities today. Next. So I think Sahana showed us enough pictures. This is a recap of just that. This very clearly shows what our cities today have come to. Either it's flooding, or it's droughts, or it's dirty water. And we are living through all of this, and that's not how it should really be. And these are some of the challenges that we, through our work, are trying to address. Of course, these are massive challenges, and it will take a lot of effort from a lot of stakeholders to reach a solution, or to reach a healthy city solution. But we have made a beginning, and hopefully we'll be able to work with other stakeholders to achieve a healthy living condition. Next. So what is this urbanization or the climate change doing to our cities? We are losing our natural infrastructure in a big way. This map that you see here is clearly showing us, it's a research that was done by Care Earth Trust in Chennai, and it clearly shows the amount of green cover that we have lost over the last 3 to 4 decades. This was Chennai on the left is 30 years ago, and this is Chennai, I think, about 10 years ago on the right. So what does this loss of natural infrastructure do? Loss of wetlands and forests essentially is leading to poor air quality, groundwater depletion, surface water depletion, along with deterioration of water quality. And this is all affecting the urban temperatures, which are rising extensively, including affecting the health of people, both mentally and physically, and of course, a loss to biodiversity. Yeah, go ahead, Nisha, next slide. Nisha, next. So what are we doing at TNC in Chennai? This map again clearly shows, again, a Care Earth Trust map. It shows the kind of urbanization that has happened in the last 3 decades. The red color is showing you the urbanization, how it is today. And at TNC, we are looking at solving or addressing this problem in 2 specific ways. And the today we'll be speaking only to one of our projects, but to just give you a slight overview of what we are doing currently as well, is we are working with the planning department to integrate natural infrastructure, that is wetlands and urban forests essentially, and even impervious surfaces within the city planning. So we all know that Chennai is in the process of developing their new master plan, which will be rolled out in 2026. So we are working with several government stakeholders and other experts to inform the city planning in a way that they are able to integrate and include or restore or even provide artificial, if needed, wetlands and urban forests in while we develop our gray infrastructure and without really compromising on our development goals. So this is a big challenge, but we are thankfully we are seeing a very good response from the government, and we are happy to say that we are progressing well, and hopefully we will achieve what we have set out to do. And the basic premise of doing such a study is based on understanding how development has happened over the last 20 years. And if business as usual continues, what it will do to our cities and our water and our air quality going forward? And to avoid that kind of a disaster situation, what is it? How can we bring in our nature, natural elements or natural infrastructure in a way that city planning can be more integrated? The other project that we are doing is like Sahana, several examples, and Anisha, can you go back? Sahana gave several examples, and also the fact that, you know, we all know that wetlands, the deterioration and depletion of wetlands is a big cause of our floods and drought situations in the city. We are trying to demonstrate a nature-based and a science-based solution to wetland restoration. And we have picked up one lake where we are showcasing and demonstrating such a holistic solution. And we are proposing that this can be further replicated in a, you know, all across the city and across Tamil Nadu and eventually Pan India. So with that, I hand over to Nisha, who will take us through our journey of this wetland restoration that we are doing on ground in South Chennai. And we are almost now towards the end of our project. So Nisha, over to you.
Thank you, Alpana. Good evening, everyone. I feel really privileged to be here, and thank you, WRI, for the opportunity to share our work in your learning series. And a special thanks to WRD PWD for enabling us to do this work and showcase it to various practitioners. And let me start about our approach on the restoration of Sembakkam Lake. The approach is like, this is one of the urban wetlands in Chennai that faces typical urban issues like pollution, proliferation of invasive species, and dumping of solid waste, encroachment by people, etc. So overall, our goal for this project has been to restore it to a level where it provides ecosystem benefits, and learning from here can be replicated across other urban wetlands. So we have always been talking about how nature is facing problems due to urbanization. But this project not only talks about the problems to nature, we also show how nature can be a solution to all the issues that we are facing. Not all the issues, but how it can help us in solving some of the issues. So our project goals has basically been this. By restoration project, we aimed at improving the water storage capacity that in turn will lead to increase in groundwater recharge. We also wanted to demonstrate how we can improve the water quality of an urban wetland by setting up nature-based treatment, which again will lead to improvement of biodiversity habitat, provides recreational landscape for local community. And throughout the process, we were also involved in monitoring the quality of the lake, the health of the lake using advanced. We also wanted to demonstrate advanced technology for monitoring the lake health. So for that, we have proposed Internet of Things based monitoring. We have started with monitoring the lake water quality for very basic parameters as prescribed by Central Pollution Control Board. And we will continue to monitor it throughout the process and after the restoration. We all know that restoration is not a one-time approach. It's a long-time solution. So we will be monitoring and maintaining it on a long-term. Going on to the approach of a project, it is essentially a three-pronged approach. One is it is scientifically rooted, it is science-based approach. And the second one is we have close consultation with the government and strong participation from the community. So science, government, and community. So these are the basis of our restoration effort. We use this as our base. And I'll quickly move on to the next slide. Okay. So about the Sembakkam Lake, it's spread over 100 acres. The storage capacity is about 10 million cubic feet. And it is one of the lakes that is cascading to a notable and a notified wetland of India. It is called Pallikaranai Marshland. It is well known for its biodiversity, the Pallikaranai Marshland. Actually, only the government can work on such protected wetlands, and we will not be able to directly work on Pallikaranai Marshland. But if we people can work on the watershed that is connecting to the Pallikaranai Marshland, definitely we lead to its improvement in health. So Sembakkam Lake is one of the wetland cascading to Pallikaranai. So any benefits achieved here will also be conveyed to the watershed and in turn to the Pallikaranai marshland. And another point about Sembakkam Lake is it has got strong involvement from the community. You can see the number of residences around the lake, and many of them are interested in the project. Some of them are interested because they are living at the lake or encroached in the lake. Some of them are interested because they want the evictions all, I mean, they want the encroachments all to be evicted. And some people fish from the lake and some people use it for like nice aesthetics and view. So many people are interested about the lake restoration project. And the environmental issues are not uncommon. As you can see, in any urban lake across India, we have the same problems here. We have a lot of invasive species growing. It has both aquatic invasive species as well as terrestrial plants growing inside the lake. There are a lot of waste that are being dumped at the lake, or it is being carried through the channels that are connecting the lake. And it has got excess of silt accumulation that is also being carried by the wastewater that is entering the lake. This is one picture on the right that is showing gray water that is entering the lake. Actually, the water is not a sewage, not black water that much, because most of the people residing here have their own septic tank arrangement. So wastewater enters the lake continuously, and it is about, we estimated or we actually measured, it is about 8 million liters per day that is entering in the lake. And thanks to the gray water that is entering, because it is one of the reasons why the lake remained, it remains with water perennially. Like in 2019, most of the water bodies in Chennai went dry. Almost all the water bodies went dry. But this one had some water left because of this gray water that is entering in. And hundreds of birds congregated in at this lake during the drought time. And it was a really encouraging thing to see, because everywhere like there is no water, this lake provided a habitat to hundreds of birds. That is one encouraging reason for us to work in the lake also. And these are some of the pictures about our work at the lake. We carried an extensive baseline survey to understand the existing conditions of the lake, so we can propose appropriate restoration solutions. We measured the water quality. We undertook tests on the geology of the lake, and the geotechnical details were studied. We had several partners working with us, and we worked with partners such as, sorry, I should have shared this in the beginning. We worked with partners such as Care Earth Trust. They are experts in wetland restoration and biodiversity conservation. And we also work with Indian Institute of Technology, Madras. They are experts in scientific assessments and giving us recommendations for water quality improvement and things. And we also engaged with technological experts, like for providing nature-based solutions. We engaged with wastewater treatment experts who are known as Finnish Consortia, and also with landscaping experts. So we worked with several people and several partners to carry out this project. So some of the pictures are like on the water quality survey, on the geotechnical survey that we carried out. And the next photo on the right is focus group discussions that we had with the community to understand their perceptions on the lake and how they want it to be transformed. One thing to be shared about the community is this is an urban wetland, so surrounded by urban community. Most of them are highly educated and from senior officers or higher level officers from government. And many of them are experts. So in focus group discussions, our original intention was to create awareness. But after discussing with them, we had a lot to learn from them. So that is one nice observation we had during a project. And the next photo shows about the biodiversity survey, which was also done in consultation with the local community and people. This survey was led by our partner Care Earth Trust. They surveyed the entire lake for its biodiversity. And that photo shows community people taking a plant. It is called Thoothuvalai in Tamil. It's a very nice medicinal herb that is used for cold and flu. And its common name is purple fruit pea plant. It's a herb. We have several such herbs in our lake. So as a restoration plan, we want to provide a habitat where these local native herbs can thrive. So some of the works in process that was based on our baseline survey. One is like we cleaned up the bunds, we strengthened it more. Some areas of the bunds were breached because people use it for commutation. Some of them take bikes, and some areas were breached. We strengthened the bunds using the excavated dredge, excavated earth from the lake, and we made it even and consolidated. Whatever mud we dredged about 1 lakh cubic meter of earth from the lake, which had led to increase of about 1 lakh cubic meter storage capacity. And as per the PWD guidelines, PWD had given us a long list of guidelines to be followed for restoration of the lake while we got a permission from them. One of the condition was like excavated earth should not be taken out of the lake at all. So whatever earth that was excavated from the earth, we use it for strengthening the bunds and also to construct our nature-based wetland system, which I'll be showing to you now. Yeah, and as I told you, about 7 million liters of wastewater was entering the lake every day. And as per the PWD guidelines, we were not able to bring in any concrete or cement or any such construction materials into the lake. So we had to use only nature-based solution for any treatment. And we were looking at wetland system. Why it is important? Because the usual or conventional approach has been to divert the wastewater or just have an interception channel to divert it to the next lake or to a decentralized waste system. If we are adopting the same approach here, the lake will be rid of water in just 3-4 months because the gray water is allowing the lake water to be filled all the time. So we thought instead of diverting the wastewater, we will treat it and let it so the biodiversity things can thrive, and it can also lead to groundwater recharge, and the lake can be protected of its area and its ecosystem services. And since it is a polluted water, for the treatment quality, we didn't aim a very higher level to drinking water quality or swimming water quality. We wanted to move up gradually. Initially, we wanted to make it suitable for wildlife and fisheries propagation. Currently, the fish which thrive at the lake are invasive species. Those which can live in surface water, or at the surface of the water, which can breathe from the surface air. But our native species are like kind of mid or bottom dwellers. So in polluted waters, they cannot thrive. So our first aim was to just improve it to a level where our native fish and biodiversity can thrive. We compared several treatment methods for this, and many of the concrete-based methods were removed. We did not use that. And these are the four basic methods that we compared: conventional treatment, semi-mechanized, semi-natural, and full natural methods that we compared treatment. And this is a comparison that we made before proceeding with our nature-based system. We have mentioned the cost for installation, the operating cost, area required for different methods of treatments, and evaluated its merits and demerits. So on a comparison, this treatment method, which is highlighted in green, if you see, it is 1/3 of the installation cost of the conventional treatment system. And similarly, the operational cost is also 1/3 compared to the conventional treatment system. Whereas on the other hand, the area required is 3 times higher than the conventional treatment system, and the merits are good. It is very good in organic material removal, and it removes some of the known pathogens also. And it involves low maintenance and monitoring, and it gives a beautiful aesthetics compared to the conventional treatment system. And demerits are, in an urban area, you cannot find this much of land to have this constructed wetlands. So evaluating all this, we chose the third one. It is we chose a hybrid method because that was more suitable to the urban situation. If you're going with the last one, the multi-stage reedbed, which is fully natural, we required 20 acres of area for construction. We could not afford that much of area in the lake. What we had was about 10 acres of lake area around the lake. So based on the land availability, we chose a hybrid method where we will use constructed wetland system with the pre-treatment by aerated lagoons. So as I told you, this is the picture of the constructed wetland. You can see it on the right. And most of the wastewater that was entering in the lake was coming from the left-hand side. So at the juncture where the wastewater was entering, we connected most of the inlets to this portion, And from there, the scheme is the water first enters the sedimentation tank where the sediments are removed. And then it goes to an aeration tank where we provide basic aeration. Then it goes to the primary reed bed that is composed of plants, Phragmites australis species is what is proposed to be used. Then after the primary reed bed area, it flows into the secondary reed beds area where secondary treatment is also achieved. With this, we are aiming to treat at least 50 to 60% of the pollution of the wastewater that is entering the lake. And the pollution load of the wastewater is also low because it is mostly gray water. And after the final treatment, the water goes through a treatment channel and then enters the lake with much reduced pollution. This involves no concrete and it is less maintenance. It does not involve any skilled labor to do it. What we maximum require is like we need power for this aeration tank where we have aerators, because we now have chosen a hybrid system. We need aerators to be run daily. So this is a hybrid system that we have adopted, but mostly it is a nature-based system also. And besides this,
Nishtha, I'm sorry to interrupt. Please keep a check on time as well. Yes. I think you need to wrap up in 1 or 2 minutes.
1 minute. Huh? 1 minute, I'll do it.
Oh, all right. Thank you so much.
So we will complete the project with a nice landscaping based on native species and plants. And the projected outcomes are these. We are planning increase in water storage capacity, that is about 1 lakh cubic meter, which in turn will lead to increase in groundwater replenishment. About 50,000 cubic meters, we have estimated. Groundwater quality improves to category D of CPCB. And we provide nice recreational habitats to local community, biodiversity, and also a demonstration of continuous lake water quality monitoring using IoT, Internet of Things. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Nisha. I think, Himanshi, the program is that we have Mr. Radhakrishna's presentation, and then we have the question answer session, right?
Right, Sahana.
All right. Because I see quite a few people have joined a little later, I'll just reintroduce Mr. Radhakrishnan again. Thank you, sir, for joining. Mr. Radhakrishnan is an assistant executive engineer with the Water Resources Organization with Public Works Department, Government of Tamil Nadu. And he is an irrigation and water resources engineer. With almost 2 decades of experience working in this field. I forgot to mention earlier, he also has a good amount of academic experience as well. And we're really glad that he's sharing his knowledge with us today. Sir has been in charge of various projects which feature nature or ecosystem-based solutions. And as you'll see in the chat, Alpna has mentioned that Sir has been very strongly engaged in this particular example that he's in right now. And we hope to learn more from Sir about how the city of Chennai is really approaching the challenges around climate change and how they're looking at using ecosystems in the future of their city planning. Over to you, Sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the TNC. And I could feel very proud and happy to be part of this scheme of things, because in fact, I could feel the women power today. Thank you for Madam Sahana and Madam Alpana and Nisha for sharing the excellent presentation. And in fact, it is not that I'm going to share my experience. And in fact, it is a learning, good learning period for me. I was under a kind of a dilemma whether to participate on this particular program or not. The primary reason for that is that I still have a doubt that whether we got a real term with the reality of the climate change and its impact on the water bodies. The reason for that is that we always have a deterministic theory in mind, and the way we think is quite deterministic. And that is, we always feel that the things can be simplified in a simple manner, but actually the nature is very intricate and complicated, and maybe the chaos theory is what the reality is than the deterministic Newtonian theories. So in that front, the day by day I start probing into the matters of the climate change, as well as the way we handle our urban development, the way we handle our lifestyle, the way we are expanding as a civilized society is making me to feel a little bit shy of talking about what I know or what I understood. But this is to a limited extent of understanding what is the insight we have about the phenomena which is happening around. I just wanted to share with you, and this is in fact both the presentation. I just wanted to thank both Madam Shagana as well as Madam Alpana Nisha for their wonderful presentation. I don't know whether I am really that structured, I have that kind of a structured presentation, but I hope that I can kind of some kind of insight into the real scenario on the field, because I am the person who is coming from the government side as well as execution side. Maybe my experience or my learning from the facing the reality will be useful to this forum to carry forward to find out a better solution for a sustainable urban freshwater and ecosystem management. So I have structured my presentation was structured like this. So it's I just want to share my school of thought about the climate change and its impact, and today's discussion is primarily on Chennai Basin. I just want to describe the Chennai Basin and the Chennai floods and water supply crisis and water supply woes we have for a long time. So I can very much share my experience with the Chennai floods for a shorter time, because I'm in the core team of the flood. Which has tackled the Chennai floods, especially South Chennai and Kanjipuram floods have been managed by our team. So then again, another insight into the water balance of Chennai Basin and the case study of Chitlapakkam Tank in Kovalam Basin. Actually, Chitlapakkam Tank is located just upstream of the Sembakkam Tank, wherein the Nature Conservancy and the Care Trust has done a wonderful work, and they're working very hard to get a better result. And at this point of time, even I want to thank Madam Jayashree, who has been always kind enough to me to throw me some more light on my wisdom or knowledge on ecosystem of water bodies, freshwater water bodies and lakes. So because I was really a new, and I was really a person of water resources and hydrology and hydraulics man, I just got into this kind of ecosystem study or a eco restoration kind of things with the inspiration of the way the Nature Conservancy, especially the way the Cat Trust has taken care of this Palikarnai swamp, Palikarnai marsh, because always there will be a clash between, I mean to say clash means that the in principle clash or conflict of interest between the conservation of Palikarnai marsh and the way it has to be functioning as a flood buffering zone as well as a conducting zone, I mean to say a swamp flow zone or a transition zone between a sea and a beacon of Bagyong Canal and a wetland. So during that process, I learned a lot from her. Thank you for the entire team. And then the next, I just wanted to show some light on what is the strategy, what we are going to adopt to have a sustainable freshwater lakes within the city, and then some kind of conclusion ideas. See, when 5 or 10 years back, when we talk about climate change, and everybody can be simply saying that it is kind of a theoretical idea that people are throwing around, and that climate change is never going to happen. So just to know that how much the climate change had an impact on us, I visited the flood, drought, and cyclones. You know, like every cyclone will be followed by flood, or even cyclone and flood will be coupled together. And naturally, the flood will be followed by a drought. Drought will be followed by extreme floods. So you can see that Tamil Nadu, as a whole, has flooded as far as many frequent cyclones. That you can see after 2005, it is a little more frequent. After 2011, it is even more frequent. After 2015, I can say that every flood or drought we are facing is having higher impact than what we can feel. So there is no need for any scientific data as to support, or even we don't need to look at any data or any kind of scientific analysis. Every common man now is feeling the pinch of the climate change and its impact, and especially in the water body and our life sustainability with respect to drinking water as well as for water supply for the agriculture, or I can say irrigation. So there is always a vicious cycle of flood and drought which is happening in our state. And obviously, every one of us, especially the environmental department people and the And at the top level, everybody started feeling that we need to act upon this kind of crisis and give us sustainable solutions. So just specifically with respect to the contest of Chennai, you know that Chennai has faced critical floods on 2005 and a moderate flood on 2008 and a very high calamity of severe nature by 2015. And then again for 2017, we had a flood, a moderate flood, and again 2018 a drought, and then 2019 a reasonable flood. So when I say Chennai has flooded, I can say that Chennai has flooded. I'm not talking cynical or too brave or too clever. I just say expressing my school of thought, whatever is comes into my mind. Please don't mistake me that if I've been above board or otherwise even a little bit point blank. So I can say that Chennai is facing two kind of floods. One is obviously based on the floods, based on the extreme climate change. That, as I said already, the climate change is a reality because from 9/11/2015 to almost 10/12/2015, we have been on the site and we have seen every extremely flood affected area. Really, for the extreme rainfall which we have seen, ranging from 350 mm to even almost about 500 mm in a single day, is a very devastating one. As far as Chennai floods are concerned, especially South Chennai and Kanjiburam floods are concerned, we had three spells of major rain in a span of 23 days. Altogether, the net rainfall happened on 23 days. It is about 2,100 mm of rainfall. Please imagine the situation that the average annual rainfall for Chennai city will be of 1,200 or 1,250 mm of rainfall. Especially for the south and northeast rainfall, it will be around 650 mm of rainfall. So instead of a 650 mm of rainfall, we have faced a rainfall in 23 days. Rainfall is 2,100 to 2,150 mm of rainfall. Especially the maximum rainfall has occurred in my jurisdiction, that is in Tambaram and South Chennai area. So the extreme right photograph which I have shown is actually the Tambaram area. This is part of the encroachments. The second tile is a part of the encroachments, which is almost completely flooded and drowned by the extreme flood. And this is the rescue mission which is happening. And the course of this 2015 floods has taught a very tough lesson to all of us. So the impact of the Chennai floods primarily due to the climate change. But the second reason is, as obviously the second tile and the first tile of the photograph will be giving you a clear idea that the very unscientific and erotic urban development which has happened in the last two decades are the major culprit for projecting this extreme Chennai flood into even more worst Chennai flood. I can say it might be a worst floods ever faced by Chennai, but it has been projected to a beyond the capability of handling the situation. It has gone beyond the limit, primarily because of the encroachments we had in the water bodies and the artificial constraints we created in the form of construction of a narrow bridge, provision of a pipe culverts rather than the bridges, or a box culverts, etc. So there are man-made reasons for Chennai floods, and also even otherwise also it is going to be an extraordinary flooding situation in Chennai. And based on the Chennai floods, we have formulated the lesson learned from Chennai floods. So that lesson learned has given us some school of thought about various reasons for flooding and various remedial measures which can evolve based on that observations could be made. So our observation, even that particular floods, you imagine that the urban flooding, how much it can cost. So some people say that it is still a conservative estimate. Some people say it's overestimate, but I can say that it is a reasonable estimate, which has been, as far as IAIC Bangalore, the net economic loss is 49,000 crore. So it is still unimaginable. It has been buffered by so many sector and so many people and so many individuals. The loss is quite abnormal. And this shows us definitely we have to act upon creating some kind of sustainable solution for tackling this extreme climate change phenomena, especially in the urban water bodies and in streams. And so just to say, before just getting into the scheme of things, this is the overall Tamil Nadu water resources map. And in the top north, northeast is Chennai Basin. And the Chennai Basin is will be having Gumaripundi Basin, which will be draining to Pulikat Lake. And then we have Aranyar Basin, the next one. The yellow one is actually Kosasthaliyar Basin. It is also called Koratthaliyar Basin. And the upper reaches are its sub-basin, Nagariyar and Nandiyar. And we have a narrow strip of pink. It is actually Kuvam. And this is again Adayar. And this is Kovalam Basin. The basin in which the Natural Conservancy, the CAT Trust is in this Kovalam Basin. And I think this Kovalam Basin is a minor basin. It does not have any river. It has a network of streams draining into Kalikane Swamp. So this Chennai Basin, which is superimposed on the, this is the Greater Chennai area. And Chennai Corporation as such, Greater Chennai Corporation now presently housing about 55 numbers of tanks. And its cumulative storage capacity is 140 million cubic meter. But to be very honest, about 20 to 25% of the storage capacity is lost due to the natural siltation, and about 20% is lost due to the encroachment or even entering of the sewage or water or black water, whatever you call. And it is also creating a lot of invasive species being breeding inside the tank bed. And I can say that this 55 tanks will be having net residual storage capacity of over 70 MCM. But actually, again, after that, there is a greater circle. And rest of the GCC in Chennai Basin is having 1,162 major PW tanks. There are about 2,100 minor tanks, which is useful for groundwater recharging or sustaining the local requirement, but it cannot be used for either major irrigation purpose or even water supply augmentation. So I am ignoring that part. And this storage capacity of this 1,062 tanks is about 485 MCM. And together, here also the problem is about 25% of the storage capacity is lost due to the siltation, because all the foreshore area of these tanks are actively involved in active urbanization process, also industrialization process. And due to this, the top cover and topsoil has been disturbed, and due to which the sedimentation rate in this tank are very high, and the present storage capacity will be in the range of 65 to 70% of the original storage capacity. And and just to show, because we are going to have a look at a case study, and I just want to have a broader picture of Chennai. You know that Chennai is founded by East Indian Company by 1639, and it is the second oldest corporation. Population by that time is only 3 lakhs. And now present population is 7.4 million or 74 lakhs in Chennai Corporation. And for a Greater Chennai Corporation, it is a little over than 10 million. So it is 10.6 million is for the extended Greater Chennai metropolitan area for a area of coverage of 1,189 square kilometer. So this is the kind of population growth we have. The population growth is urban population growth is not only due to the natural population growth. It is also because of the expansion of the jurisdiction or the area of control of the Chennai metropolitan city. Chennai metropolitan city originally was having about 1,070 square kilometer. Now it is expanded to 426 square kilometer. Naturally, it becomes the popular city in India. And as far as the city water supply is concerned, it is having primary water. So primarily, I'll share the presentation also to you. And primarily, PW was looking after the water supply of Chennai city. And then by 1978, the Chennai CMWSSB, Chennai Metropolitan Water Supply Board and Sewerage Board has been formed. And they have been supplying water to this Chennai city through four major reservoirs, namely our Red Hills, which is also called Pundi, Chodavaram, Chembrambakkam, and then Pundi, Red Hills, Chodavaram, and Chembrambakkam, four reservoir. And then always we are facing the shortage of water due to the increased population as well as the urban water demand. And then Telugunga project has been commissioned by 1996, and it has to bring about 20 MCF water. 15 MCF water is our share, and 3 TMC, excluding the 3 TMC losses, and you'll be getting about 12. We have to get a 12 TMC of water, which accounts for 930 million liters per day. But actually, what we are realizing out of 12 TMC is that at the best period also, we'll be realizing about 6.5 TMC due to the various reasons, especially the vagaries of the rainfall, as well as the losses in the canal and also the drift, which is happening throughout the canal. People are pumping it or siphoning it for irrigation purpose. So at the end of the day, when it reaches the Pundi, the average realization is about 4.5 TMC, excluding all the losses. And even after this Telangana project, we faced a critical shortfall in water supply. Then the new Veerana project has been commissioned. It is conveying water from the Kaveri basin tuned to 180 MLD. That will be accounting for 1 TMC of water supply for a shorter period. And besides this, we have a 200 MLD of desalination plant, which is also created by the CMWSSB. Shares of the water supply is also given just for the glance. And this is what I'm just discussing about. But this bottom line is important. And we have about storage potential of 15.4 TMC all together, all the reservoirs together. But actually 10.6 has been realized in a normal day with a 70% dependability. And then during critical period, we are realizing only 8.37 TMC of water. And this is the graph is obtained from CMWSSB. There you can see that there's always a deficient period between mid-June to mid-October. And this period, we are always in shortfall for water supply. Even for the old Chennai city, I'm not talking about the expanded Greater Chennai city. Expanded Greater Chennai city deficiency, you can see from this one. So as per the United Nations projection, World Urbanization projection, it is 10.98 million is the projected population, and for which 138 liters per day is going to be 1483 MLD, and which is, you can convert into annual domestic demand, is 19.1 TMC. And with the social industrial demand, the net requirement is 26.74 TMC. And the actual supply potential is 15.4, but the actual supplied and the supply realized at the supply end is 10.6 TMC. And the net potential deficiency is 4.7 and overall deficiency is 16.5. Even if you miss every point, which I'm just saying, whatever I'm saying, the take home point is that 16.05 TMC is a deficit in water supply we are having. So what we have done is that we have conducted, we have taken individual sub-basins. We have done with the ECRAS and EKHMS, we have done a modeling, and we have done a water balance study for each and every basin we have in China, each and every sub-basins of Chennai basin. That is RNER, especially for RNER, Kuvam, Adayar, and Kovalam basin, we have done a water balance study. And the gist of the water balance study is given here, and how many, this is for a typical case of Adayar basin. We are having a 827.4 square kilometer of sky area, out of which we have major tank is 122 major tanks. And the annual dependable yield is 3.1 TMC, and the storage capacity is 6.1. Sorry, this is annual surface runoff at the tail end actually. And the storage capacity available is 6.1. What does it mean is that the net yield available in the basin is about 9 TMC, but we are surplusing out of the outlet of this particular basin. Similarly, for the Kovalam basin also, we have done a study, and the insight into this water balance study, just want to project it at this particular contest. You can see that this is the absorbed flow at the tail end of the reserve.
Yes, Radhakrishna, sir. Sorry, we have time limit. So I'd like you to wrap up in next 1 minute.
Yeah, surely.
Yeah.
So the understanding is that based on the study, and we understood that the climate change is bringing in a lot of flash flood into the system, into the Chennai basin. And the Chennai basin, which is basically urbanized to a larger extent. I think that we have seen many examples shown in Bangalore here and there. Even if you take the Chitlapakkam and Sembakkam case, this is the old GIS sheet, and see how progressively this entire land cover and land use pattern has changed between these two, between 1975 to 2021. So the rate of discharge, the coefficient of discharge, coefficient of runoff, which is converting the rainfall into the flash flood into the tanks, is drastically improved. And we have observed that it is in the range of 45 to 50% flash flood is coming into the tank. So we need to have a kind of a sustainable remedial measures for this urban water bodies. So typically, like Sembakkam tanks, we also done a work with Chitlapakkam tanks. This is a desilting and dredging work we have carried out. And you can see the aerial photograph. This is the almost we are in the end. We are also going to finish parallelly with the Sembakkam tank, which is done by Natural Conservancy. And we are formulated a three-pronged strategy of conservation of water, which will truncate the peak flood in the downstream side. And conservation is a source of conserving water at the source or at the catchment or pre-catchment, and then climated up the rehabilitation and eco-restoration of the tank has also been proposed. In addition to that, after this, the tail end or at the flood prone area, we are going to carry out the flood protection works and training works. So this particular idea, this particular flow diagram will tell you the exact idea of, due to the climate change and erratic and unplanned urbanization, we are going to be getting excess rainfall, and it has to be conserved as much as possible and try to reduce the discharge to the downstream side and remodel the existing tank system into a climate adaptive tools and climate adaptive irrigation infrastructures or water infrastructures, and for which we are providing a special arrangement called this additional outlets and also emergency fuel slugs. And we have provided a cut and cover, that is additional drainage beneath the road, etc. So the conclusion point is that we should understand, and every stakeholder of this meeting, as well as we have to inculcate all the stakeholder, that the climate change is a reality, and it is causing colossal damages to the urban water body and the system ecosystem. And that coupled with the urban poor urban planning and the insensitive urban planning is the reason for that. And the radical change in the land use pattern in Chennai region, Chennai basin, is causing havoc in the entire flood scenario, and also it's causing subsequent drought in the year. So it is urban water bodies, and we need to be remodeled for the new climate regime. And we should not look for a quick fix solution. We have to find out a sustainable solution for not only creating urban sustainable urban water bodies, and also to tame the climate change. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Sahana, over to you.
Great. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for the very detailed and presentation and all the in-depth information you were giving us. I see this sort of one question, but Alpana seems to be responding to it in the chat. But Alpana, do you want to take a just speak quickly about it on the mic? So essentially, this is a question about who are the stakeholders in the lake restoration work, I think.
Yes, so I didn't quite get what you mean by who are the stakeholders, but in brief, we are working with the government, close engagement with the government, with the immediate community that surrounds the lake. We have experts who are advising us on the project, which Nisha mentioned during her presentation. We are working with partners, and we have some corporations who are actually giving us some funds to make this possible on the ground. So I'm happy to answer specific queries that you may have on this issue. And Nisha can add.
Right. I think Himanshi is asking if all of us speakers could turn on our video for a minute. So Nisha and Alpana, and sir, if you would please. But I do have, and Himanshi, I think we are good for time for a couple of questions, right?
Yes, you have 5 more minutes, and then we have to hand it over to Ankita. Yeah.
Okay. So actually, I did want a little bit of follow-up also probably to Nisha, if you will, just given your details that you were giving about the lake restoration project. I understand that first off, there were these PWD guidelines, which are very strict in terms of what is allowed within the lake area itself or not. So two parts to it. One is if you would have any knowledge of how and why PWD came up with these sort of very strict guidelines on protecting the lake in this manner, that you can't remove any of the material from the lake itself. And the other thing is that given these restrictions that are there, Obviously, as you said, restoration work is a long-term thing. You have to do it very regularly at different points. So do you have any future plans on when you do future dredging and such interventions, how you would deal with the material that comes out at that point?
I don't understand the second of your question. But on the first part, like why PWD has given a lot of regulations and guidelines for the restoration one. When people start restoring the lake, we remove silt. And in some cases, it is being illegal. People may use the removed silt for their personal uses. They may use it for construction, things like that, for their own benefits. That is why PWD has come up with a specific guideline that no silt that is removed from the lake should go out of the lake without their permission.
Okay, so with their permission.
Dr. Radhakrishnan, Mr. Radhakrishnan is there. He'll be able to add more to it. But this is
I just wanted to tell you, the extraordinary challenges what we are going to face is with such kind of project. Madam has clearly said that even for this treatment, rebuild and other things, we required about 6.5 acres of land. I'll tell you one thing. But for me being an officer over there and maybe but for the Jayashree ma'am being the coordinator for the project, no officer in Tamil Nadu, not only Tamil Nadu, anywhere else will allow the tank bed to be used for treatment plant, whatever may be the reason. So as a water resources manager, what our people will say is that you do nonsense planning and nonsense development and then come to my water body to encroach upon and do a water treatment plant. But I don't want to be that skeptical because mistake has happened. So the collective responsibility of the society and the individual also. So we wanted to give a sustainable solution in the form of permit that a part of the tank water spread is being used for creating a sustainable treatment plant. That was eco-friendly treatment plant without using any concrete or permanent structure. And these people also came with the Nature Conservancy and this people also with a very nice proposal. We accepted it. I'll tell you one thing, to move forward this proposal along with anywhere else in Tamil Nadu, it's impossible or improbable if, again, I'm not going to become a HOD of the department. So if I happen to become an HOD, you had the privilege of even asking me a little more. And as rightly said by Misha, the problem is people swindle this earth also for their personal benefits. So in case of Chitlapakkam, we officially got permission and conveyed the earth and increased the storage capacity. But here, what we suggested is that dump then in a higher ground level. Later, we will dispose it off officially. It is not going to be left out there itself. The department will take the responsibility of disposing it off, because that's again supplementing. You people are supplementing our role. You are taking thanks to the Natural Conservancy and then Care Trust, because they have shared the burden of the government or maybe the departmental official to restore the tank in a systematic manner. So I take this as an opportunity for thanking them. And also you should understand that on reality, we are traveling in a very toughest path. So actually we require double the width of the channel, double the width of the river for the new climate change regime, because coefficient of runoff is increasing and the rate of flash flood is increasing. But what we are having is we are left with only one third of the existing channel because of encroachment, technical or non-technical, or illegal or technically illegal, legally illegal. So legally technical. So this kind of problem, to sort it out, we are taking the underground drainage system as a macro drain, cut and cover. So it's very intricate. But I just wanted to send a message to this entire forum. You people are doing wonderful work with this kind of interventions and also with this kind of webinar and meetings. But I just wanted to tell you that even any small effort, we should have start a campaign with which every stakeholder, especially public, should be inculcated about a day-to-day activity which leads to reduction of the climate change. Say it be conservation of water for shaving or even for utilization or recycle of water. You please, I see the women power a lot in this group, and maybe you people should start spreading a little more on focusing more on educating the people on taming the climate change and also reducing the gray water into the system. They can reduce, they can go for gardening and recycling it. Please do that. And as you rightly said, it has to be removed, ma'am, and we'll be supplementing their role. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, sir. Well, thank you to sir and to Alpana and Nisha for participating in this. I think we are just at time, so I'll hand it over to Ankita to
get the fan. We see Mr. Krishna from one of the participants. He wants to ask a question.
Please.
You are unmuted, sir. Please go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. Thanks for giving me a chance to speak here. Basically, I also am doing my doctorate in sustainability and finance, both hand to hand. Okay. So I have certain questions. I've been studying coastal management. I've been doing other studies about environment and all those also. Basically, even though I am in engineering in faculty, I also teach in colleges. So here when I say stakeholders, Hello.
Yeah, please go on, sir. We can hear you.
Yeah. So when I say stakeholders, do we particularly identify each and every community or a group of people who are actually affecting the conservation as well as the pollution? So it's both sides. See, when I say stakeholders, maybe there are fishermen around. They may be either affected, their business may be affected, or maybe even after their business, the leftouts which are there from that fishing operations may tend to come contaminate the particular area. So have you particularly identified such stakeholders in this one? Because I think that's more important as far as conservation thing is concerned. Basically, these are the points at which all this issue starts. The basic issue of contamination or basic issues of any problems, they start at the stakeholder. Because if the stakeholders don't participate, or even if they don't keep on track, your work which you have done, you have done a very good work, but that work should be sustained. It, even though you have adopted all the sustainability criteria, if the stakeholders do not participate in the operations of that particular thing, you are not able to sustain what you have developed as a sustainable thing. That is what I am going to specifically I am mentioning here. So that's why I asked this particular question, whether the stakeholders were specifically identified in this particular project or not. I think the forum is getting what I want to see.
Yes, or I can elaborate. We did identify all these stakeholders that you mentioned, and we totally understand that without their support, participation, identification, engagement, our plan will not be sustainable beyond our work on the ground. So Nisha, feel free to elaborate here, but whether it's the fishermen or the immediate community who will actually be using the lake, we have worked with everybody.
Madam, it's the input that was I was interested in the input of what we have obtained.
Yes, sir. I shared this initially when we mentioned about our approach. Ours was a three-pronged approach. And when I said government and the third one, the community was comprising the fishermen, the local residents around the lake. And all of these people were consulted through several focus group discussions. In fact, we shared one of the photos there. We took the perception of how the lake is and how it is to be transformed and what are the components they need to be incorporated in the lake restoration process. We reached out to, as I said, low income group, middle income group, and also highly educated people to take all of their perceptions. Not only that, we also took a gender-based approach. We specifically reached out to women in the area and asked what were their thoughts about lake restoration. Because usually when we call for this focus group discussion, only 95% only men turn up and we don't get to hear from ladies. So that kind of classification also we have done and reached out to people. And other stakeholders besides community was the local municipalities. When we talk about a solid waste problem or the wastewater that is entering the lake, that is being handled by the local municipalities. And they were also interested to have some decentralized treatment system which they can adopt. So this is also done in consultation with the local body. And any of the intervention that we were doing at the lake, including from dredging the lake or removing the solid waste or keeping access for storm water to enter the lake, because in some points it was blocked. So we are discussing with the community to even understand where there used to be higher stagnation, where there used to be extra channels, where we need extra channels. That kind of consultation we are doing with the local communities, and we are also consulting with the fishermen there, like on what benefits we need to focus, kind of thing. That's why we also spoke about the fisheries point, fish propagation point. We did a basic classification, like primary stakeholders, secondary stakeholders, and the tertiary stakeholders, and we made a point that we involved with, we get all of their thoughts.
Thank you, madam. I would have appreciated if one slide was there about the inputs and the interventions you based on the inputs you, because that would be have been a much more better learning in the session, because the participants who participate here, very frankly, I have a 3.5 decade experience of field working. Presently, I am in charge of 1,000 crore work, so it's all in marine and the other projects also. But the inputs that we get for the stakeholder, from the stakeholders, and the interventions are much more important, according to me. Especially, I joined this session because as I told you, I'm pursuing my doctorate for sustainability, and I'm trying to somehow assess sustainability and financial viability. So that was an very important question for me. So if next time,
from the department side, we understand that the Natural Conservancy team has done even far more better the stakeholder consultation than even the government department.
Yeah.
So actually, personally, as you said, I'm also having a vast experience of handling the people at the site. But we are my team is quite different. But still, even compared to the best of the best team we have in Chennai for this kind of works, they had a wide consultation, sir, because they too consulted the line departments also, even the municipalities.
My only point is the
time constraint for presentation has been restricted them not to depict too many slides. That's it. That's all.
Yeah, that's all right. Exactly. I would have appreciated if inputs would be
shared. Surely it can be shared.
What were the interventions?
So your point the time is a constraint. Even I do have a lot of transparency to do slides to display, but the time is a constraint.
Right. Thank you, sir. Mr. Birmole. Thank you for your question as well. Thank you, sir, also for adding. And I'm sure, Mr. Birmole, you can connect offline with the Nature Conservancy team to ask more. And I'm sure they have much more of the project that we can't see in just a short presentation, the fine details of it. Thank you again to all of our speakers, Mr. Radhakrishna, to Alpana, and to Nisha from the Nature Conservancy for giving your time.